Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Katrina has lost her voice with an iron allergy, I'm afraid. But it's my pleasure, therefore, to welcome you to the fifth lecture in this year's History and Heritage series at University College Isle of Man. And I'm very delighted to be able to welcome Professor Sir David Wilson this evening. Sir David has led a very distinguished career, both as an academic and as director of the British Museum. A world-renowned expert on the Viking Age, he's published many books and articles on the subject and has received numerous distinctions, including honorary doctorates in Norway, Sweden, and Denmark. And his choice of career as a medieval archaeologist was influenced by his early encounter with the crosses in the Lich Gate at Kirkmichael. And so it's very fitting that he joins us this evening to shed some new light on Manx crosses. I hope this works. Here we have a picture of the great man Kermit, not as he's normally seen. Here he is as a country gent and probably as a masher as well. But he was obviously hag-ridden because of all the including, I think, Cushag leaning back with her bonnet on the floor, and then there's Mum's umbrella to keep them in order if they're not. Anyway, he is the great man. He's the man who wrote Manx Crosses, published in 1907, a book which is still enormously valuable and which has never been replaced. And I'm not going to replace it, I'm going to write a sort of summary thing which is going to come out, I hope, sometime this year. So, let us start. Now, which one is it? That's it. No, is it?
Yeah.
I would remind you that you're living in the middle of the Irish Sea, and this matter is often forgotten by people who are writing on this subject. What we have here, we're surrounded by Celtic-speaking people for a lot of the time, of which we're talking about now, British, if you like. But it's the end of the Roman Empire. But I put on this map because it has some of the very important places. Whittorn, Carlisle's up here, then there is Mells down here, which is a marketplace, and then there are all the places in Ireland which were not working at the time I'm going to speak of, which is the period between about 550, say, and say 900. A lot of the items that we're talking about are simple crosses like this, scratched in some forms very, very roughly on pieces of erect stone as memorial stones, sometimes more elaborate and possibly datable. But these are not, and they go right the way through in graveyards. Now, I would remind you that we're in the middle of the end of the Roman Empire. This is a map of all the ports and markets and headquarters of the Roman Empire at its greatest extent. And you can see that Britannia up here faces onto the Irish Sea. And of course, they had a great fight in Anglesey, otherwise known as Mourne. One mustn't forget this Roman background, because they had sailing ships at that time. Everybody thinks of the sort of first sailing ships in northern waters being Viking ships. This is probably not the case. These are Mediterranean sailing ships. They have seas just like the Isle of Man does. This is on a late Roman sarcophagus. And this is the sort of ship of some sort that would probably be working in the Irish Sea at this particular period, because
obviously the Romans didn't want to have anything to do with these people. They didn't want to conquer the people across the sea, but they wanted to have a lot of trade with them. And there are just a few traces, which are being gradually being confirmed, of Roman presence in the Isle of Man, or at least of the presence of Roman items in the Isle of Man. Coins, for example, and also now more clearly, some brooches. Now, we're also talking about what had happened after the Romans left. The Romans officially left in 410, if you believe all the books, but it was probably in the beginning of the 5th century. It had been a collapsing empire at that particular time. And the people who were left behind, the British, were Celtic-speaking, as far as we know. Leeds was called Lloydis, for example. And it was divided ultimately into a number of kingdoms. One of the most important is this kingdom here, which doesn't really appear until quite late. It's first mentioned in 7th century sources, and one doesn't quite know what happened here, but there were two kingdoms, basically Bernicia. Oh, sorry, I'm speaking of technology. There was Bernicia and Deira. And this is Northumbria at its greatest extent. It came all the way down here, and actually it's not quite at its greatest extent, because later on it came across Galloway here. And it was probably down as far as the Mersey here. That's not that. Here is the Mersey, I think. This is a funny map, isn't it? But at least you get some idea of the importance of this kingdom. It was sometimes separated into two kingdoms, Bernicia and Deira. And the introduction of Christianity to these areas was quite difficult. The first one was into Deira, and that was when Edwin, who was king, was converted in 627. It is alleged by Bede, who was a fairly reasonable source, that he was one of the people who conquered the Isle of Man, so he at least knew about the Isle of Man, if nothing else. The whole of England, however, became united by the time of Edgar in 975, and there is a famous description of him coming up for a ceremony after he'd been crowned in Bath to Chester, where he had an assembly in which there is a man who is identified probably as the King of Man, or it was a number of kings that were there. Now that is what I want to talk about a bit today, because it became very important in my argument. Now, it's not the only, too many buttons to press. This is a figure, a rough figure of a kingdom known as Dalriada, or Dalriata in Irish. And for those of you who were brought up in my generation, it was Dalriada, because everybody talked English over here. It was a very important Christian kingdom, and I'll come to that later on. Its bounds are based on 7th century sources, and it was founded by an Irish dynasty about 500. These are all very dicey things. And from Ireland, and two monasteries from Durrow and Derry, you get Durrow and Kells, you get a rather shaky idea of the Christian situation in Ireland. There were no formal bishops then. Ireland was basically monastic. It had been founded by people like, Palladius, more popularly later by Patrick, And then there was also another missionary, St. Ninian, who settled in Whittle. The capital of Dalriada was about here. It's a place called Donad, which has been excavated and is quite a well-known one. But Dalriada was conquered basically by the Picts, or another nasty people, who lived in Scotland. You know, there's the sort of great stuff in the sort of 1066 and all that buildings. So the Picts were here, and there was upper Pict land and lower Pict land, and then you have Strathclyde here, which was one of the places which they came to. Galloway here was probably part of Dalriada at one point, almost certainly was. Strathclyde was not really anything but a geographical name, but the important thing is that this whole area here ultimately became Northumbria, and by the end of the 8th century you have a bishopric in Whithorn, which is formal for about 70 years, based on York. So this is the complicated situation. But what we have got is a very lively Christian community here by the end of the 6th century. It was not an organized Christian community in the way that we know it today. Bishops were known by name, but they were also often not bishops in our sense. They were not territorial bishops. They were heads of monasteries in the Celtic Church. This is what we must call it. And they actually had lots of other names which are too complicated to go into here. But the whole of that monastic situation was what eventually brought in from Iona, which is here on this funny map. I think that must be Iona. Anyway, here is Lindisfarne down here, and from Lindisfarne, the whole of the Irish influence in Northumbria grew. This was all settled at the Council of Whitby in the 7th century, which we're not going to at all. It is a complicated situation. All I want to make sure of is that you understand that this is a flourishing connecting point because of the monasteries that came over here and were founded in Northumbria and probably also in the island. So that's enough of this sort of nonsense. We will go on to a more recent story. This is basically a timeline. The Roman Empire in the 4th century was under a man named Constantine, who was actually proclaimed editor, proclaimed emperor in York. And in 313 at Milan, he had an edict which proclaimed the tolerance of Christianity throughout the Roman Empire. And it became, because it was a royal, imperial edict, it was adopted slightly, in some cases more than slightly, for instance in France, as the main religion of the Roman Empire towards the end of the 5th century. Now, from Rome, which was already the centre of Christianity in the West, came Palladius, who has been much maligned because he's been overshadowed by St. Patrick, who came over a little later than him to Ireland. But it's very interesting that he was sent from Rome to the Irish believing in Christ already by 431, and according to the documentation, which seems to be firm. And this is quite interesting because there were Irish there at that time. And this is the reason that one of the things that we've got to keep in mind, because the Irish church was probably the British church, not the Irish church at this period. It was this hangover of the Roman Empire, people who had got moved over towards Ireland and also towards Wales and also towards Scotland. So a bit later on, no, quite a bit later on, St. Ninian came from, we think, Gaul to Whithorn about 563. And just at about the same time, St. Columba founded the monastery at Iona, which became an enormously important monastery until it was ultimately destroyed by the Vikings. It was in power until, anyway, the middle of the 9th century, and then rebuilt up its power again after that. Then you have the missionary bishoprics, which bishops, missionary adventures, you know about St. Augustine in Kent, and who came to Rome in 597 and gradually converted parts of England. Paulinus, or Paulinus, however you like to pronounce him, came to Northumbria in 625, and he was the man who converted Edwin. In 627, Edwin gave in to this, but it didn't last in Northumbria. This is the complicated story. But by the end of the century, by the end of the 7th century, the whole of Northumbria became Christian under York. One other thing was this matter I mentioned before. Aidan from Iona came to Lindisfarne, and that actually meant that the Irish element, Christianity, caused the Synod of Whitby in 634, when the Rome insisted on the date of Easter as the central point. The Irish had a different date for Easter. The Irish Church had a different date from the Roman Church. It was eventually settled by tough guys like a man called Wilfrid at Whitby, and the Irish then gradually filtered back into Ireland. The head of the monastery in Whitby fled to Iona. He didn't flee, I think he was allowed to go to Iona, and eventually he ended up in Ulster. But from that time onwards, there was a constant contact between Ulster and Northumbria, across through Whithorn, because Whithorn also came into this area, and also probably through Wales. There is a certain amount of evidence that Wales was also part of this nexus, which stretched from east to west across northern Britain, northern England rather. And the Isle of Man was in the middle of this, and this is enormously important because at that time, we begin to get a lot of evidence, which I want to bring out today, at Mackle, of the presence of Christians, of a Christian monastery, which seems to be founded on the tradition of this Hiberno-Saxon, whatever you like to call it, Christian tradition. Now, we start the actual object. It's a period after the lintel graves were being made here in the Isle of Man. Now, the lintel graves are these graves with sheets of mudstone at their side, and probably capstones as well. They go right the way from probably, and in your presence, Dave, Peter, I don't really want to dare say anything about this, but probably from the beginning of the millennium, right the way through to about 1000, at least on St. Patrick's Isle, we have probably got a continuity from the period, not necessarily as early as that, but at least from 500 or 600 onwards. Now, what these graves must have looked something like this when you look at them. This is not an old church, and here are the tops of graves without any headstones, which reflect possibly the tradition of the lintel graves. And this is what a graveyard might have looked like. We have very, very few evidences of this. I'll show you one later on, which is not at all like it, but that is the sort of everyday grave. But there is another sort of monument, and that is a standing monument, which is almost certainly a grave marker. And these are monuments which the Welsh and Irish fight over the data. I've given up. For some obscure reason, this one, which comes from the Isle of Man, is called 7th century, while this one, which comes from Wales, is called 6th century. They are the same principle. The inscription runs this way on both of them. The lettering is the same and everything else. So this is a 6th, 7th century monument. Now, the one problem about the Manx, the only Manx example, it's one from Santon, is that it is, it could have been a cut down slab. It could have been cut out, because quite a lot of these which are found in Wales look like this. This is exactly the same tradition. This is in Cardiganshire, but there are a hell of a lot of them in Wales. We just go back for a bit. This is just says Aviti Monumenti, the monument of Avitus, Avitus being a chap, as this man was, who is called however you pronounce it, and he Hic Iacet, and so on. And the Hic Iacet thing, here you see Hic Iacet, here's I-A-C-E-T, means here thrown, that means he's laid down here. And then he is of the tribe here of Ordovis, the Ordovici, and this is probably the last trace of the Roman, the tribes of the Roman period, the Ordovician tribe, who inhabited this area of the British Isles. At Balaquini, we have another type of stone. This is in Ogham letters, and it actually reads, as you can quite easily see, as Doviadana, son of Drota. Now, it is quite possible that Drota is, it says, Doviadana Macqui Drota. That might well be a formula for a tribe, but we're not going to go there either. We'll go there later on. Now, the Ogham alphabet is, this is the principle of it. It's strokes on either side of a line which read through most of the Roman alphabet. It is actually able to write Latin inscriptions quite easily. And here, on this stone from Nocky Duny, in Andreas, you have both a an Ogham inscription down the edge of the stone here, and a Latin inscription here, which says, "Imbicatus or Amicatus, Macqui, son of Ricatus," and that again is a Hic Iacet type of stone, because here it says in Latin, hic jacet, here it just says amicatus, maqui. Now, having blinded you with all these ghastly names and everything else, you don't have to remember ever. Let's look at a decent English name which appears on these stones. Because after all, Max were English upon stage. This is a stone found in Mackwood, and it is a stone with a runic inscription here, which you can all read, BLA, Glagmon, it says, which is a very common, black man, it means, the same as black man, and it goes on into the Middle Ages, quite a common surname and a Christian name as well. And this is on a Christian cross, within a ring at Mackwood, and is another of the elements in this Christianity. This is later. This is probably 8th century. It's probably a Northumbrian origin. The black man is probably a Northumbrian name, but the runes are almost certainly the Northumbrian runes. But this time the runic inscriptions really didn't extend much further south. There are a few in the south, but they are basically in Northumbria. And I'm using the word Northumbria here in the term I talked about earlier. Now there's another element here, and this is another stone from Mackwood, which gives us a clue as to the type of person who is here. This is a stone in Mackwood, which is extremely interesting. First of all, it has an inscription around here, which is partly nonsense. A lot of them are, of course. But what it does say is Christi, in the name of Christ, day of the island, Episcopal. S.P. Episcopus, De Insuli. And this is almost certainly the name of a bishop, or the sign of a bishop, who didn't know his letters. But this is a seal from Suffolk, which is of 8th, 9th century date, and has an episcopal thing here, to a man called Ethelwald, who is a bishop of Dunwich. And it's very interesting that this is the same design as this. And we have a number of Anglo-Saxon seals, and Simon Keynes, who is a professor of Anglo-Saxon in London, in Oxford, in Cambridge, sorry. They're all the same, really. The Golden Triangle, and I've been belong to two of them. He is studying seals, and he's one of the Keynes family, jolly near, bought a very, very fine one the other day. Couldn't afford it. He is convinced that I am, that this is a symbol of a bishop in Mackwood. Well, it could have been called Sacerdos or something like that. He needn't necessarily have been called a bishop. And on this are two crosses, one which says Crucis Christi Imagine. That's very easy. That's the cross of the image of the cross of Christ. And then it says probably Jesus in nomine, in the name of Christ. And so on. And this goes over both of these crosses. It is a type of cross which has a hook at the top. We'll see some more of this. This is, in fact, a relic of the Greek Cairo, which we see elsewhere in the British Isles. Here at Kirkmadreen, not very far from Whithorn, and here from Whithorn itself. And you can see all these hooked crosses. And you can also see it on this, the earliest insular manuscript, which Trinity College Dublin, the Usher Gospels, where you have got the hook here. And this is the beginning of one of the Gospels, second Gospel. And here you have an Alpha and Omega, Christ, I am the Alpha and the Omega, beginning and the end, as it comes to be so called. And these actually are based on a North Italian type of manuscript, and these would be little hangings, possibly in gold on this thing, in the original, which hung from the arms of the cross. Now, this is a 7th century manuscript in the Mediterranean tradition. It is paralleled by the crosses. If we go back and look at there and there, you see the same thing in all of them. It is a compressed version of the Alpha and Omega signature. Now, here in Mackled, on Mackled 51, this stone here, you can see the Omega. This is a broken cross, of course, it would have been around here, and there would have been an Alpha on the other side. So in Mackled, you have got all these things. You have got Latin and Greek, and you've got scholarship. And then, this is the same stone taken from that picture. This is the stone nowadays. Now I'm going to have my rant here. This is a disgrace to the Manx nation. It has been sandblasted by the dust and grit in the crosshouse at Mackled. Neither the church nor the museum can do anything about it. It's probably the bloody mindedness of the church, it usually is. or it may just be silly parishioners. But this is a disgrace. And fortunately, the stones in Kirk Marshall were moved indoors in 1966, I think, and they are much better condition than these. If you look at the Mackled stones, a lot of them are in really rotten condition, and something should be done about it, and anybody with any influence in it. Of course, we've all got influence, but let's talk to the people. The bishop before last, Noah Jones, I raised it with him, and he went up to the wall and said, he couldn't get anywhere with anybody. The time is right now because the crosshouse is falling down. It is being preserved because it's quite possibly rightly, because it is the work of a major architect. But watch this space and do something about it. Now, end of round. Now, another of the stones, very similar in form, but not certainly in order, is this one from Mackled, which is enormously important because it says this inscription here, Christi, Jesus Christus, Branui, hoc aqua derivat, derivavit, it ought to be Avid, but it's Evid here. Branwy, name of a man, brought water to this site. And that is one of the most important things, of course, if you've got a monastery, you've got to have water. And this is an absolutely classic insular uncial script, and half uncial, really. But here you have Jesus Christus, you see. And here you have Branwy, hoc aqua, and then you get down here, D, that's a peculiar D, D-I-R-A-B-I-T. Absolutely classic, beautiful script, a script that would be used in manuscripts, and this was produced at Mackled. So there is a very good chance that at Mackled you had got a literate, learned person. Of what nationality, we don't know. But as with the Vlagman cross, it is possible that what we have here is this commonwealth of Christianity, which stretches from Lindisfarne on one side to Ireland on the other, which includes Whitehall and includes Wales and also the Isle of Man, and that Macleod was in the stream of people travelling backwards and forwards. It was much easier to travel by sea in those days than it was by land. And at this time, there would be quite a lot of boats floating around or sinking in the Irish Sea. But it's very interesting. You get quite a lot of records of travellers. For example, Wilfrid, Bishop of Ripon, set out when he was in trouble to go to do a missionary trip to Germany. And he went to Southampton, and took a boat, just like that, to go to the continent. And this was the way you did it. And then he would be protected on the way by the various monasteries which acted as hostels or hotels for these people. And this was the situation all over. These places were places where travellers stopped, were given food, given rest, and caused a cultural commonality. So that when you get Boniface, for example, in Fulda, being murdered by the Germans, nasty Germans, he was actually struck on the head by a sword and martyred, therefore. And he was holding a book over his head. And you still see the slashes to this day in a manuscript in Fulda Landesbibliothek. And that actually is quite possibly a relic of St. Cuthbert, but not probably the one that was on the battlefield at that time, because it's an Anglo-Saxon manuscript, a diatessaron, that is a sort of a reader's digest of the Bible. And there is an Anglo-Saxon book there, absolutely splendid for him. Same, he bought books from Northumbria to Fulda. And so Alcuin of York, when he went to work in the empire in the period just before Charlemagne, he actually was sending for books backwards and forwards between the monasteries in England and in the schools of the Germanic Emperor, the Carolingian Empire. So there we are, there's that. Now, simply through with these things. Here is another stone from Bride, which McAllister, one of the few people who has actually published these inscriptions, said this looks more like the work of an illiterate schoolboy. And these are obviously, these things here, these inscriptions here, are quite clearly an attempt at graffiti on the back of this curb or the front of this stone from Bride. And you see it is exactly the same form as the one we saw with the Alpha and Omega lead. And that is probably just a chap who went to preach there or something like that from Macleod. And we get one or two other examples. Now, there were other interesting influences about. This is a cross which is now in the museum, and I put this enormously bad photograph of it on, because it does actually show these figures much more clearly than you would see them in the museum. Another thing in my rant. And they are, in fact, Paul and Anthony, early fathers in the desert where they were fed by ravens, and this is a very common thing on Pictish Christian sculpture, and it appears on Irish Christian sculpture as well, and this is part again of this commentary of or commonwealth of Christianity trading backwards and forwards, and the Pictish stones were of some importance in the development of the art of the Manx crosses, although very few people now believe that, except me. And Ross Trench Jellicoe, and one or two other people who are actually unreliable. This stone here from Lonnon, again outside but not quite as badly treated, is again a symbol here which might well be a very famous type of mirror symbol on Pictish stones. And there is this contact, you see, between the west of Scotland and the north of Scotland, possibly through the Great Glen, down to the Western Isles, and then to the Isle of Man, down to Iona, for example, and then to the Isle of Man. It's a bit dicey, that one, and this is quite late. This is late 8th, well, late 9th century, possibly, with the spiral foot to it. But this is about the time when the Pictish stones were well developed. Here is another cross which has from Mackle, which is in the same form basically, except that it's got a disc at the base. Now that could be another Pictish symbol which is a double roundel. It more likely comes from 8th century Frankish coins which have you have the cross standing on an orb. But I'm not totally convinced by my own arguments, so don't you be either. Now, we'll now go on and have a look at one or two of these crosses. This is a cross which was found at Portivulum, and it's made out of the local granite. It has a rather coarse, but rather easily read inscription, which says Crux Guriad. Crooks, the cross of Guriath, which is probably a Welsh name. It's made of granite. Where did the granite come from? Here. This is what an 80-odd-year-old man does, you see, nowadays, cautiously across these numbers. But this is the area where you get this big outcrop of granite on the beach at Portivulum. Now, it was found just above that beach on the road, and it was, Kermit said, or I think it was Kermit said, it probably came from a keel further back. I'm not going to go into keels tonight, because they're not anything to do with this period. There's no keels in the period, so forget about them. This is probably the, was carved down here, and it may have been the carver whose stone was put here. And it wasn't shifted uphill to Mackle. But not all the stones are in the same stone. This is a stone, another stone from Mackle, very similar in form and so on. And this is some sort of limestone from the Castletown area. Now, I said I'd go back to graves a little bit. And here is the Ronaldsway site, that beautifully excavated site. We must be polite about our places before the war, and it's a rather important photograph of this because this stone here, I'll show you in a minute, or you might as well see it first, is this. You see, a stone with a basically granite stone. Which is possibly not Manx, it may be an erratic from the Ice Age. But the crosses here are very similar to some crosses that we have in the Isle of Man, and the three crosses are the crosses on Calvary. And then you have this very familiar cross with this in it. Now, this was found here. I think it's this one, but it's not clear from the report. They could be here, actually, because these are posts, standing posts of stone, which is a type of tomb which occurs in certain parts of Western Isles and Northern Isles of Scotland. There are two possibilities. This is a relic tomb, if you like, of an important Christian, possibly a cleric. But the other one is that it could be a liat, which is a platform on which there were crosses erected and which on which the sacraments were, from which the sacraments were administered. There is one surviving one. I am now convinced that it's original. I have often thought it was a garden room. That is St. Patrick's Chair in Moraine, and I think that that is a layout. And it has two crosses, standing crosses, among the three standing stones on it. Go and have a look at it. It's in the field, and fortunately not as much danger as many of the others. Now, so that's the thing, and then you're beginning to get to a period when the stones were being decorated, and this probably happened towards the end of the 8th century and went on through into the 9th century. And here is the stone from Lollin, which is still standing in the churchyard in its base. It is possible. This is its original position in old Kirkmullen Church, although, again, caution, because they move them like nobody's business if they wanted to. And here is one from Braddon, of which there is some doubt, but which I think has enough traces of Scandinavian influence, and on Mondays, Tuesdays and Wednesdays, I think it's possibly done in the Viking Age, and on Thursdays, Fridays and Saturdays, I think it's not done. Sundays, I have a day of prayer. But what is happening now, you see, is the whole thing is covered with this interlace pattern, enormous amount of interlace on it. And that is a feature which is beginning to creep in elsewhere. Here, for example, at Whithorn in Galway, and again, get this whole pattern here, sort of overindulgence in interlace. And here, on two of the stones, we've seen this one before, and here's another one. It's very common in Pictland. It is not quite so common in England. In fact, it's hardly found in this sort of tight form in England. So, then there is this. But that's another story for next time. Thank you very much.
There is time for some questions for Sir David.
Yes. Does your work tell us anything about change of the Gaelic language from Brittonic form to the Irish form in this period?
When I was an undergraduate, I avoided Celtic languages like the plague, and I'm not the story of the present language is a different one and has been well written up by Robert Thompson, who's the only person who's written sensibly about it in many, many years. And what we have nowadays is basically a late form of possibly Cumbrian Welsh or something like that, Gaelic language. And that's all I know and all I can say. I'm sorry about that, but we want another Robert Thompson immediately. So if there's anybody young in the audience, they're all in the other room, we could actually get that person to learn some Gaelic and actually sort it out. It's quite interesting, actually, that I have a granddaughter at Cambridge who's studying linguistics, and because she once taught at school in St. John's for about 3 days, she got terribly interested in this and was given took as a thesis in the teaching Gaelic in a modern context. And her supervisor said, first go and learn Irish. Which is all right for a Celtic language specialist, but linguistics is a terribly different subject, and she more or less collapsed at that point, quite rightly too. Irish being the most difficult of the languages in any case, but I mean Irish is rather different from sorry about that.
Irrelevant. I was told today about a group of 13 crosses engraved down near the shoreline, just south of the mouth of the Sankin River. Each cross was described to me as just like five squares, one in the middle and four arms in it. But do you know
anything about them, Peter? I've seen these things and they're very peculiar indeed. They're not like the group of crosses in the cave. That's what I went to see them about, you see. How many were there, do you remember?
There
were quite a lot. No dating at all, but there's like a lot of these scratch crosses and things like that that occur. And they
how deeply incised are they? I don't know, I was just told them.
Not very. Well, they're sort of half an inch or something like that. More, you think? Yeah. Possibly, they must be if they're down there. Because it gets a lot of the easterly gales flowing straight into it. Yes, no, I don't know anything at all about them. There are a number of these places that have got these crosses. Witchhorn is the famous one. There is another one on Arran, I think. Maybe Arran, somewhere in the Western Isles. And there's, of course, an enormous amount of ruins in Calm, but they're much later ruins. Calm in those houses. A different matter altogether. These are just simple crosses, dedicatory. They may have been a sort of place of pilgrimage. Maybe it's somebody looking for a salmon or two and doesn't get them. But nothing else can be. Sorry, I'm not being very good on this today. Any other questions?
The plaiting that we see in some of the mackerel crosses in that infamous hut, is that all late also?
Practically all late. Let me get this straight. I have left out the whole of the Viking Age, which in the Isle of Man amounts to about 120 years from about 920 onwards. And they take over some of this planet. But they also introduce another element, which is the Scandinavian style. There are not very many of these in the island, and in Mackold, there's one fragment which is extremely interesting, which may have an Anglo-Saxon background to it. Yes, there are one or two, but they're not in that sort of form. But there's one very fine fragment about that in Mackle, which is extremely very similar to the ones I've been showing.
Any other questions?
What determines the use of language, whether it's Latin or and how one see the decline of one versus
I know you're Latinist. I think that Latin was the smart language of the clergy, and the and runes were a demotic script rather than a hieratic script of Latin. But the Latin was pretty ropey here in a lot of places, but it's not all that bad for the period. It was not everybody's taste, but we don't know from the sculpture here what the manuscripts were like. They may have been doing manuscripts as beautiful as a book of Kells, for all we know. We just do not know. Book of Kells was probably painted in Iona, and no shock horror there. I once said that in the United States, and two priests got up and walked out. and so in the western part of the British Isles, there was a very good tradition of this, as well as on the east coast, where the Lindisfarne Gospels was painted at Lindisfarne. I think that you had a class of people who were the historians who had to write, the analysts, priests were often sort of wayside pastors, I think, but quite a lot of them in the monasteries settled down and did some writing. The hierarchy of monasteries in this period is not terribly well known. There is the famous St. Gullan plan, which I'm sure you know in the Bible in Sudan, which shows a layout of a monastery which has everything in it, from hen houses to scriptoria. And so I think that the priests presumably learnt their office by rote, possibly not even knowing the language, but the boss priests probably did have to know the Latin language, which was the common one used. And most of the documents of the church are written in Latin, although the Anglo-Saxons, for instance, were writing very fine English, as you well know. The Alfred, of course, laments the lack of literacy in his famous introduction, but he encouraged the learning of language and the writing of literature in the church in his days. We don't have a lot of information, I think, about the West in this way. I don't know that quite answers your question, but I think it's roughly the situation. Most of my
What do you think should be done to protect and preserve the crosses?
Take them out of the museum and put them in into a place under the supervision of a conservator. Don't try and do anything to the surface. Let them dry out naturally on conservation terms, and then build put them inside the church or put them in a building.
That's what I thought, and I hoped you would say, because I mean there isn't the money there to create a museum, but I mean in time, I mean, it could be a wonderful tourist attraction if they had a man. If most of them could.
And
be
who says
together.
There's not the money there, actually? There's a lot of money in the island, and nobody ever asks for such a job in a big enough way.
Well, if we had a few less SMAs, the money
would be there. Well, if you cut the House of Keys in half, there's to be quite a lot of money there. No, I think, no, it's the only thing to do, and it's been done. If you want an example of it across, go to Leeds Parish, no, not Leeds Parish Church, Ilkley Parish Church, and the crosses were all outside until about 30 years ago. They were then moved into the church, mounted inside the church, and left to dry out in their natural form, and it worked. And I think that is how present thinking has it. But the different stones have different demands. And the limestone of the south and the mudstone of the north, and or of most of the island, and the granite, all right, different. And one mustn't also forget that granite isn't all that good a stone. It is a very soft stone as well. Everybody thinks it's hard as granite, but there are only certain types of granite.
Number of churches that are either redundant now or becoming available.
Well, yes, what the hell are they going to happen to the
houses? I mean, one or two of them could be used as.
There could be a major sort of good to take, I think, if you like to call it, of crosses in the island. But I think it would be rather nice if they were kept in the parishes to which they belong, because that's how they have been preserved. And I see no reason why Mackle, which has no longer got a full congregation and is no longer the seat of the vicar, it's in the care of the vicar, why that shouldn't have all the crosses put in there. But don't do it as they did in Kirkmichael, where the crosses are too close together. And to see some of them, you have to go down underneath to have a look at the runic inscription on them, and they're too close together. You must enable people to be able to photograph them and study them, and not encourage people to sort of crawl about in them, as I have done when I've been talking to people on the site. Now, I think that's the answer, David, and I hope that the museum will take some notice of this.
I hope so.
Well, I look at
Katrina.
Everybody's boiling hot.
Yes. Well, thank you very much indeed, David, for that stimulating and, in some senses, provocative, which we hope may generate some action, particularly about Mackle. Thank you very much indeed. The next lecture in UCM's History and Heritage series will be on Wednesday the 15th of March, when Dr. Katie Cooley will be talking about the Manx Stone Axehead project. I hope to see you there. If you're not already on our mailing list, then to be kept up to date with forthcoming events, please feel free to leave your email address on the table there before you leave. So until next month, thank you for coming. Thank you again today.